is going to talk about integrating library metadata in a semantic web research environment for university collections.
Okay, thank you, and welcome to my talk, in which I will not show you any theory or so, but more practical steps I took in an ongoing project about, as the title says, university collections, and especially about integrating metadata from our library collection into our collection portal that will or has to be built in the course of the project. But first, let me tell you something about university and academic collections. If you are not familiar with that, in Germany we have over 1,000 collections in university and other academic institutions. All these collections have are very heterogeneous in many different ways. This, for example, you have the collection of objects are of different materials, different genres. The objects have different conditions, but also the collections as a whole. And also documentation and digitization is very, very different in each collection. There have been studies or statistics, so you can say that about 60% of all the collections are not accessible digitally via the web, and only 40% have high quality digital images. This is of course a bit of a problem because research and education today is mainly digital, or a lot of is done digitally, and so you can't really access these or work with these collections as they are thought or for their primary raison d'etre. So at our university, we also have about 20 or more, some 20-something collections. They also share the heterogeneity in all aspects. And they are also scattered all around the university and all faculties and so on. And this has historical reasons, and this also has administrative implications. So till now, for example, we have no common presentation of all the collection objects in a common portal or something. A few years ago, I think about 8 years ago, the university installed a central custodial agency. It's called Zentralkustodie in Germany. And this agency develops a digitization strategy for all the collections. So here you have some pictures from our collections. You see there's very very big variety, and for this digitization strategy, we applied for a project at the German Ministry for Education and Research, and we got a grant in a current research line. And our project is called Objekte im Netz, this objects in the web. The project is ongoing. We are about in midterms. And its main goals are that to develop common standards for documenting, especially digitally documenting our collections. That is, we want to develop best practices and guidelines for our collections, but also for other collections to reuse them. And we also want to provide software tools for this process. The means we are applying is we are not starting with all the 20 collections at once, but we selected 6 pilot collections, namely the medicine history collection, mineralogy, music, prehistoric archaeology, and school history, and also the graphics and prints collection from our university library. All these collections represent the whole bandwidth of collections that we have quite well. and all the heterogeneity. As from the software tool side, we mainly use the WSSKI research environment as a common platform for indexing and research. And this WSSKI software uses the CDOC CRM as a common data model. So we will have a look, short look at, on the system and the CDOC CRM, how we use that. WSSKI software, WSSKI is an acronym for Wissenschaftliche Kommunikationsinfrastruktur, which can be translated as scientific communication infrastructure or scholarly communication infrastructure. And it is basically a virtual research environment for cultural heritage documentation, especially the software was stems or was developed from in the museum community, so it's especially thought to match the needs of museums. But as we found out, it also is very well suited for research projects in the digital humanities, for example. Yeah, it's made for managing complex network-like data, and in its backend, the data is stored natively as RDF triples with the OWL ontology, CDOC CRM OWL ontology. And on the front end, however, you have a more Wikipedia or wiki-like interface where you aggregate all the information for one object or one entity in one single page, so that you have one central point of information for each entity. From the technical perspective, WSSKI is just a set of modules for the others add-ons for the Drupal content management system, and also one triple store that you need to have. And so you basically need a XAMPP stack and a triple store, and that's it. So it's I think rather low tech. Okay, let's have a closer look at how the back end and the front end work together. So we, as I said, the data is stored as RDF triples. In a triple store, you also can combine local triple data with external triple data, for example, from name authorities. And but at the front end, you have this aggregated view, as you see on the screenshot. On the right-hand side, you have this tabular data and an image and so on. You also may want to have text or, videos or 3D objects or whatever. But all the information is actually stored as a triple graph, as you see on the right, left-hand side. And how is this information combined? Well, we have in WSSKI, we have something we call ontology paths, which is mainly a mapping between graph patterns, which actually every field in our front end or every data item in our front end matches to a path through the ontology graph. That's why it's called ontology path. There's also a graphical user interface for managing all these paths and arrange them, group them, and so on, so that you can make up the whole front end. Okay, that's the technical aspect. Now, CDOC CRM is used as a top ontology. CDOC CRM calls itself a reference ontology. So we use it as a common denominator for all our data. Beyond that, we also introduce new concepts, that is, we extend the CDOC CRM with a whole bunch of domain ontologies. For example, we have one ontology for all our collections, and then for each collection or each discipline, we have another more specialized domain ontology, so that we can establish layers of understanding of common interpretation between the collections and maybe data outside our collections. Yeah, of course, because we are dealing with collections and collection objects, we have the class collection object introduced. That is also our main entry point into our data. But of course, you can always define other entities like places, persons, events, and so on to browse and access your data. Okay, this was the whole setup of the project. Now I want to go more into detail about our graphics collection and how it is integrated into the project. We have at our university library, we have a rather small but renowned collection of paintings, sketches, graphics, prints, maps, and so on. And only the prints are about 5,000, and 2,000 of them are cataloged according to bibliographic rules, and thus are available online. The metadata is available online. But only 12 of them have actually digitized images. This is only for the prints, not for the painting and sketches. They have other numbers. So the information is available to us in two systems. As a university library, we are part of the Bavarian library network, and it is organized as such that the title information, the expression or work information in verbal terms, is stored in the library network in an Aleph system from Ex Libris, and the item information is exemplar information is stored locally at our university libraries in an OCLC CSIS system. So we can access these 2,000 the metadata for these 2,000 prints, and we can access it by an OAPMI interface and an SRU interface, and both deliver MARC XML data. So our question was in this project, for this collection, how can we integrate all this bibliographic metadata into the overall collection model that uses CDOC-CRM, and how can we integrate the data so that it can be used along the data from other collections in the same portal. You have to know that for all the other collections, they don't have something like these bibliographic standards that libraries have, like for example MARC and as we have RDA and libraries. So they have other things to do in the project. They don't have these standards. And so we just established CDOC-CRM as a common standard for them. So now the question was, now that we have the CDOC-CRM as a standard, can we, or how can we integrate the metadata from the library that is just recorded in another way? So we came up with a first approach, and I think this is from a linked open data perspective, this is a very good or a neat approach. So we thought, well, we can just dynamically fetch the information from the APIs, from both APIs, because you need both APIs, because one piece of information is only available in one API, and the other information comes from the other API. So we need to query both, but this is no problem. We get the MARC records, and then we use these standard conversion style sheets from MARC to BibFrame in the version 2. And then we get a BibFrame, RDF, BibFrameized RDF triples. And these can be grabbed from by Whiskey from an REST in, API. And in Whiskey, we can just align the CDOC-CRM data with the BibFrame data, in the sense that we built these ontology paths once for the local CDOC-CRM data and for the authority BibFrame data, so that we can align both ontologies and both data sets. This would have meant that we have our local data, and aside we have the library metadata as an authority file in our system. So this all sounded nice, but then we implemented that about half a year ago, but then requirements changed. We had new features wanted to be implemented and so on, and we found out that this doesn't work so good, and so we just revised our approach and have a more quick and dirty approach now at the end. And the main difference is that we just eliminated the conversion to BibFrame and do a direct conversion from MarkXML to the CDoc CRM, and we also eliminated the dynamic fetching of the data and do static imports and updates periodically. So there's a nice feature in Whiskey where you can import data from SQL databases, and we basically use that to map from the MarkXML with the help of XPaths to directly to the Whiskey system. So here's it's illustrated. We have for each object we have basically two Mark files, and then we have this SQL import mapping that directly imports into the Whiskey system and fills out the data so that the data is actually local data after that. Okay, so why did we do that? Well, it's not theoretical questions, it's just practical issues. One thing is that with the SXLTE conversions, we got incomplete or incorrect or inconvenient RDF triples. I don't want to blame the scripts, I don't want to blame anybody, but after a long series of conversions, the data that we get doesn't look like the data that was introduced once into the Aleph system. So there we have some, maybe because we are dealing with prints and not with books, we have special meanings for special fields or something. I don't know exactly, I must say, because I'm not a librarian, I'm not a cataloger, so I don't know exactly, but somewhere some information gets lost and the RDF triples are created in a wrong manner. Also, we don't want to have blank nodes, which the XSLT script produces. On the other hand, we don't want to, dynamically fetch the data because it's too has a too low performance, and we need to build an extra search index for that. So it was also a bit too cumbersome. So storing the data locally just fits our needs better. Okay, these were the main aspects, but in the process of making that import, we also had some further observation that I want to share. There were, for example, technical hindrances. The APIs are not 100% conforming to the specs, so libraries that we wanted to use just failed, some failed without notice, so we just thought everything is okay until we found out that data is missing and so on. So this was quite time consuming to find out what exactly does not match. And we also missed some officially coined URIs so that we could cling into and fetch maybe more data. This is no big problem because for all the other collections we have to coin our own URIs because there is no authority like that. But as a university library with a library network, it would be nice to have someone to create officially coined URIs. And from a modeling perspective, one observation was that the most collections don't have specialized Ferber concepts in the sense of work, expression, manifestation, and item. But because most collections just have unique objects and not serial productions, or even if they have serial productions, they don't really care about that or don't care as much about that. they mainly collect the information for a single item and not for work and so on. So we had at the beginning, we have diverging models, and we were in the process and still are in the process of getting them together, harmonizing them. Okay, so thank you very much.
Thank you, Martin. Yeah, thank you. Do we have any questions or comments from the audience? Okay.
Hello, I'm Stephanie Rühle from the State University in Göttingen. We will start at the beginning of next year a project with graphic collections. And I'm really interested, you said you used also domain-specific ontologies. It is what you call domain-specific ontologies with Cytoxerum, this Fabergé standard. And if you have more than that to describe the prints, I would be really interesting if I can find it somewhere. Because when we are starting our project, we don't want to start from nothing when there is already something. We're interested in that, and also interested in your mappings and scripts for the mapping from MarkXML to Cytoxerum.
Okay, so the ontologies, they are available on the website of the project. You find them somewhere. It should be a section download or something. So you will find them. There's, as I said, this hierarchy of CDOC-CRM, which you don't find, but then the other ontologies, you will find them. There's a common collection ontology, and then you will find an ontology for the graphics collection. And the scripts, they are not on the website, but you can, I can show you. As I said, this is there are scripts for the input, this input feature in Whiskey, so basically, you will have to extract information about how to map it.
Thank you. Here's another question on domain ontologies. Can you maybe give a rough estimate on the overlap of the top ontology of CDOC-CRM and the domain needs? So how much coverage can CDOC-CRM provide already? And how much do you have to somehow to extend it in order to fit the particular collection? And when you're doing when you do extend the ontology, would you say there are best practices or a systematic approach to do so, or is it more intuitive and based on the domain expertise and dialogue with the catalogers or domain experts?
Okay, so well, the CDOC-CRM is very very generic. So it really does, from this theoretic point of view, it really provides, I don't know, maybe 90% of what you really need. But as it is generic, it doesn't have, of course, the specific concepts that you want to have. Maybe, for example. As I said, we have a class collection object. There is no class collection object in CDOC-CRM. There's only a material thing or physical thing or whatever it's called. So you have to, if you want to be more specific, you have to create your own class that is a subclass of that. Of course, you could also use the CDOC-CRM concepts as they are. But I think this is, if you use them in as a native data format, so to speak, then you immediately run into the problem that it's too generic, and if you want to do specific queries or show specific information, then you only have generic classes and properties, and you get too much information. You know? So, for example, if you have a class person in CDOC-CRM, and then you want, but in your domain you want to distinguish between artists and, I don't know, funders, for example. So, and you only want to show artists, then it's very convenient to have a class, and then you just say, give me everything that is an artist. or give me anything that is a funder. If you don't have that, maybe you just ask for persons and then you all the funders and I don't know what get shown, and not only the artists. So you have to make a much more complex query to get only the artists, maybe. And one best practice I want to say, I think it's not generally agreed that this is best practice, but we try to introduce new classes as often as possible, because we always say it's more more easily can revise a newly introduced class and say, okay, this was too specific, and we just go up on one level in the hierarchy. Then if you have to split up one class into two and reclassify all the instances. So we always try to be as specific as possible.
Okay, thank you again, Martin. And then...